Welcome to the Be Your Own Superhero Women's Leadership Conference, inspiring the superhero in you. Welcome to episode 3. We feature Sandra Hodge of Clay It Forward. Sandra will be speaking about being true to yourself and embracing your creativity.
Thank you, Catherine. Honored speakers and fellow superheroes. How do you like that for my Toastmaster greeting? Catherine's a natural speaker. I met her, I was trying to do the math, I think it was about 10 years ago, which ages us both. And I just love her style, her honesty, her genuine self, and her ability to tell her story. When I was in grade 8, I came home one day toward the end of school, and my mother, you know, captured me at the door, and I have to talk to you about something, and it was kind of frightening. And she told me, you've won the creativity award for grade 8. And I cried. And she knew I would need comforting because I had my mind set on winning the all-round girl award. But I wasn't quite round enough. I'm rather tall and angular in a lot of places. I had good grades. I was involved in school plays. I was Dorothy in The Wizard of Oz, mostly because I was taller than the other munchkins, I think. I could do math pretty well, but I was not an athlete, so I was not an all-round girl. My best friend got the all-round girl award. I still like her. She was an athlete, and we have come to find our own spaces in life. Being the winner of the creativity award has sort of relegated me sort of to strange places in life, because creativity is often seen as the thing that you do when you have nothing better to do. When you're done all of your real jobs, when you've done the real work, then you can go and be creative. You can draw, you can read, you can tend to your garden, you can write, whatever it is, these creative things that you can do. But they're all sort of fluff, and you can see that in the school systems, all of the music programs, the art programs, all of what I consider the essential skills have been dropped because they're hard to measure, they're hard to account for. You can't get into the best schools by drawing a good picture, often, unless you're going to OCAD or to one of those schools. But even then, your parents will really, really try to discourage that and say, well, maybe you can do a minor, but don't you think you should be an accountant, Peggy? I admire Peggy because she can do it both. She has both sides of her brain working. She can account and she can write and many other creative things too. Like Catherine, I have trouble with many things. That's why we're kindred spirits, I think. Technology is one of them. I don't have a slideshow because I'm the kind of person that walks into the bank and people will turn on their machine and say, oh, this used to work. This just worked. I can shut down machines. I don't even try to do that sort of thing. So last night when I came in, one of my Toastmasters speeches recently was on mnemonics, little memory devices. So I looked around the room and I made little hooks on all the little sets going on. So I can draw attention to each of the stations around the room and talk about creativity as the thought comes to me. So I go through life being this creative person. And in my family, they still loved me, all right. But I think the older I get, the more I realize that many of us think that we were found under a rock or adopted by birth. Being an English teacher and being privy to so many people's private thoughts through their writing, I think it's a fairly universal feeling that none of us really thinks we belong anywhere. And we all think that we're oddities of nature of some sort. And as the previous speakers all talked about, we have these masks that we go out into the world and pretend we're capable adults, and people listen to us, sometimes our children among them. And we have these professional entities and lies, but really deep down beneath, we're often still 4, 5, 6-year-old children that are saying, am I good enough? Or she's so much better than I am, and why can't I do this, and why can't I do that? And it was a great boon to turn 50 because so many things just didn't really matter anymore. And it was the greatest boon one day to wake up after emergency surgery, which turned out to be colon cancer, in which they took out all of my reproductive organs, which set me free in a lot of ways. So I look at Main Street Salon and I think of wellness, and I think waking up not dead is one of the best things to happen to you. A number of people in this audience who can speak to that. Maria has a book about that as well. Near-death experiences are kind of a good thing, and one of my coaches, Andrea Ribmeyer, I've been had the pleasure to join a mastermind group. She's also a Toastmaster, and she at Shabby Motley later on in the month will be hosting a death cafe, which I think is just great because it's the one thing that we're all afraid of besides public speaking. So you can go to Toastmasters for them both. And that whole thing about living and dying and how transitory everything is and how fleeting the moments for everything are, waking up, and it was around Christmas time, I had my surgery, this was in 2010, and got home and I was alive and looked at the Christmas tree and I thought, I really don't have to do anything. It could have been the other way and I wouldn't even be here or in some better place or who knows where. Talk to Maria about that. And I really don't need to do anything. All of the stress Lisa talked about, I'd been doing crazy things in a career, enduring a rather stressful marriage, just being a mother to two stepchildren and two of my own daughters, pets, craziness, getting up way too early, staying up way too late. And your body, as Lisa talked about, will give you these clues that we just pretty much ignore until they knock us down, as Catherine talks about. So when I was knocked out and got up from it, I vowed that I'm only going to do what I want to do, which is creative. So I was given the gift of being able to make snurtles and correct run-on sentences four different ways. So you don't choose your gifts. These are the ones I was given. So okay, fine, I give up. That's what I'll do because I like it. And I vowed that I would just do what I like to do, and I would just hang out with people that I like to hang out with. And I would mostly, now that I've got this little death thing in my brain, because it brings it sort of to the forefront, just take care of a lot of the stuff that I've ignored for 50 years. And as the previous speakers have talked about as well, that means there's sort of that dichotomy of being a superhero. Yes, we can do everything, but it doesn't mean we have to do everything. What we can do is ask for help and create those networks, not only on the personal, heartfelt people that we can talk to, but also the professionals. Go see Peggy to straighten out your boxes full of God knows what's in there and just give it up. And as Catherine said, and Lisa talked about, it just takes up mental space when you have all of these things just screaming at you, all this stuff that we collect that we don't do anything with. We'll get to it, we'll get to it, we'll get to it. We're all queens of procrastination. And what I really had to do, because given my left to my own devices, I'll just sit there and stare at clouds and listen to poems flow through my head and draw little sketches and muck around in the clay. So I really need to go to the left, because I'm happy in my right side of my brain, but I do know I have a left side. I know I can do things linearly, logically, but it's an effort. It doesn't come naturally, but it is another language that I know I can learn. And part of that learning is reaching out to the people who do it well and making friends with them and getting them to help me. There's a good book called, I don't know, I forget what the book is, part of the chemo, that's my greatest, oh, it's just chemo brain, it's just wiped out all of my memory brain cells. So a lot of my conversations are sort of like charades. I'll say, sounds like whatever, so you may have to participate. Jill Bolte Taylor, there you go, it'll come eventually. But she had a stroke, and she was a scientist, and she lived in the left side of her brain. And when she had her stroke, she went home to her mother, who helped nurse her back, and she really discovered the right side through stained glass, and she was able to merge those two and make that connection. And I would really encourage people to adopt creativity, because we are all creative beings, and I think that we really need to nurture that. And creativity can be anything to anybody. It comes from the Latin word creare, C-R-E-A-R-E. When I'm at a loss for anything, I always go to the language, go to the word, see where it started, see where it came from, and where we can go to. And that grounds things for me. It makes sense. And it just means to make. So, okay, we all make things We make messes, we make chaos of our lives, but we can also make tidy little piles of them too. We can make efforts to reach out to help us. We make children, we make a home, we make a meal. We're all makers of some sort. Often I think creativity is thought of as, you know, painting or something eclectic and rather grand, and it can be, but it doesn't have to be. And it just, I would argue, it's one of those systems that's integral to life, just as, you know, I'm quite aware of the digestive and elimination system now since my little foray into the world of oncology. And I would propose, too, that creativity is another necessary function of the system. So when we eat food, it comes in and it has to go out. When we breathe in the respiration, the air comes in and the carbon dioxide goes out. Our skin, the perspiration, that's a way of cooling. And just that flow of stuff coming in, stuff going out, I would propose that with our hearts and our minds and our souls, we're always taking stuff in and that we let it out through the creativity, whatever that is, making something. And as Lisa said, put it in every day, every moment of every day, just something where you let it flow through. We often think that we need to just work, that little hamster brain that Catherine has going on in her autopsy. And we think we have to work, and then we'll get a holiday maybe next March, maybe for a couple of days. And then we holiday, whatever that means, and then we usually regret it and get back to the work. I suggest that you build a holiday into every day. For me, it's red wine at 4 o'clock. For the resveratrol, that's right, because that's healthy. And, you know, green tea and honey, real fruits and vegetables, all those healthy sorts of things, but getting that flow through. What I've devoted my life to is this Clay It Forward program, where, again, the mentors that I've met through Toastmasters, seeing counselors, going to mindfulness meditation, just really finding out who I am and honoring who that freaky little girl is in a really tall body now, and just being okay in our own skin, which is really the hardest lesson that we all need to come to eventually. When I do the Clay It Forward, and that sort of emerged out of a number of different things, but I met another mentor, Robin Sutherland, who has a group called Thinking Rock, and she has brought a lot of trainers up to the Sioux. She came back another two-brain girl, or she's got the bridges working beside in both of her brains. She has her degree in economics from the London School of Business, and she's also a theater type. So she's able to do what she does creatively and artistically and make money at it as well. So Peggy talked about that too, women entrepreneurs or something about us. Oh, we do this really cool stuff and we're crying, but I love it. And we do it for free, or we undervalue it, we give it away. And just finding those mentors that will help us give value to what it is that we do. And unfortunately, that often means putting a price on it, but finding a way to do that with integrity so that we feel that we are making what we're worth, which goes back to that whole thing, what am I worth? Is this good enough? And why am I really doing this either? Robin brought these trainers up, and with that it just gave a context to what I do, this whole thing of community arts, where you take non-artists, but I propose that everyone is a creator too. I have a friend, Zoe Wood Solomon, who paints in the Ojibwe style, and she says, when I paint, I pray. And I really like that. So without being any denominational, just that whole spiritual thing, when you're in the moment of doing a complex craft, whether it's knitting at Shabby Motley, or whether it's doing clay, or whether it's planting your garden, you're in the moment. And you're not in the past, you're not in the future, you're just in that Zen place. And it doesn't matter what it looks like at the end, we're not looking at product, because that's another thing. Well, people tend not to do what they think is creative, artistic. Oh, it's not very good. So when I do my shows, people, especially adults, they're so damaged, because they say, oh, well, I can't do this. No, I can't draw a straight line. And they'll make all the, just physically be backing off. No, I can't do that. Well, I'll bring my grandchildren the next time. And they're just so afraid to do something wrong. Or if the children will come and do it, and then you'll see these people, these grown-ups devour, okay, you move forward, let me do it right. So It's no wonder we're all just such messes, hot steaming messes, that we need to go and see Lisa and her friends to get us unmasked. And anyway, when you do that, when people find, I say, it's okay, it's just cookie cutters, you're just putting a stamp or you're just putting your finger in it, you're just leaving your mark, because that's another thing. I think we all have this urge to leave our mark, to make an impression somehow. And really, in a lot of ways, nothing matters, but then in a lot of other ways, everything matters. It matters to, and it needs to matter most to ourselves. And what we need to learn to do, and that I tell my daughters, you know, mothers of daughters, we've talked about that gender thing, mothers of daughters especially have to say often, treat yourself the way you would treat someone that you cared about, right? Because we often treat ourselves really, really poorly. And if we treated someone that we cared about the way that we treat ourselves, we wouldn't be very good friends. So we really need to make friends with ourselves. In a lot of ways, it's just recognizing the gifts that we're given and just accept them and just not being able to say, well, I wanted that one. There was a good book. Besides going to the words, also going to books is helpful for me. It was called, or it is called, Sacred Contracts, and I forget the author again. But it, do you know who it is? That's the one. See, Peggy knows all the books too. And that was a great relief to me, because it argues that when we pass through this earthly realm, we're given, we have sort of eight houses, and everyone has four in common, and then we have eight other specialties. And that was a great relief, because whatever these gifts were, whatever contract we signed when we signed up for this little excursion, that's what we're meant to do. And of course, there's a dark side to them all. But just that awareness took a lot of pressure off. You said, okay, well, now I know why I'm not like her, because that's not one of my contracts. So it was really grounding. A couple of other things were helpful too. Another analogy in a business book was that we need that team. Even though the superhero, we can do it all, we really need a critical team. And I like the animal analogy. On every good team, you have to have a hare, which is the idea guy, that's me, and it goes with harebrain. So often the creatives have lots and lots of ideas. So it's a blessed curse or cursed blessing, because your brain is never stopping. So you really do need to just sit and make snurtles for a while just to stop the brain. Turn off the radio, turn off the TV. Like Lisa said, get away from people so that you don't have that noise going on. So you got the hare, then you have the owl, who's the strategist. Got quite a bit of that. And we all have all four. All of these things, we all have four, but we usually have more, one or two. The third one is the tortoise. That's the critic. I have none of that. Nothing that says, oh, maybe that's not such a good idea. None of that. And the squirrel, who is the detail person, the person that just does the thing, I don't have much of that either. I can do something once, and then I'm done with it, and I'm on to the new shiny ball. That was really enlightening too, because you just need to collect friends like that that can do all those different things. Because again, it goes back to, oh, you can do it all. Another book, The E-Myth, entrepreneurs who think that they want to create an art studio or a painting studio or something, or set up a bake shop. Do something that you really, really love to do, which is fine, but then you get into it and find out there are 19 things that you didn't even know existed, and you're certainly not very good at. And that puts a quick end to the pie-making business, because you're up all nights doing everything else that you didn't need to. So just that humility that often comes with age, too, to recognize that we need to ask for help and get the people on the right bus and in the right seats and all those analogies and doing what we're meant to do, because we can't do it all. Look at the bar. The trigger for that is, as Lisa alluded to, when we do complex crafts, it releases all those feel-good chemicals, the endorphins, the dopamine, and it shuts off the cortisol, which are all the negative things that eat away at us. Look at the front door, or the door there, gatekeeping, who you let in, who you let into your world. Often we have very stressful people that we can't really get rid of. They might be parents. They might be children, they might be bosses. We just sort of have to endure. So you have to come up with these strategies of enduring the people that aren't necessarily so supportive. And learning to trust our own voice, that yes, this is my little claim on creativity, and yes, I am going to make a mess in my studio, and it's going to be that way all the time. We'll put up a curtain so you don't have to see it. You have to negotiate. Do these things that make you be able to do what it is that you were meant to do. Looking at the food, again, at that system level, I think the creativity is necessary for that flow. When we look over there at the table where all the door prizes are, creativity has all kinds of different looks and feels. It has different prices. It has different returns on investment. And whatever creativity is to you, you know what it is. You know when you're doing what you're meant to do because it feels right, and only you know what that does feel like. That's an effective pause. Notice I'm not saying or ah. Learn by that Toastmasters. I know. The other thing I like to do is listen to the radio, CBC or NPR. Terry Gross is a great interviewer. And the other day I was listening to that at 4 o'clock after walking my dog. My daughters are in Thailand this year, and it's beautiful to have an empty nest, except they left all of their animals. So there's a horse that they took care of because I don't need to deal with that. And there's a cat, which I don't mind because he just sort of comes and goes, and we have a very good coexistence there. And there's this dog, this very needy dog, who's getting really big. She's almost a year old, so she's like a seven-year-old, just really needy and really insistent. And she pees all the time, needs to go out, needs to come in, needs to do this. But it has got me back walking again. And who's our diabetes lady, whose tagline is walk your dog whether you have one or not? Our golden retriever, Jane, yes, Springleson. Our golden retriever died a couple of years ago, and it was sad, and we'd always had dogs, and I thought, okay, this is it. No more dogs, I'm free, the kids are grown up, just deal with this cat, and then we end up with this dog. But it does get me out. It gets me walking. I don't run, I don't do anything physical, because I'm not an athlete. But I'll save that for you because I almost am. I am. I was saving that for my closing. Yes. So I walk many times a day, and I don't even like to walk. But it is that empty space. I walk down by the water. I live downtown on Woodward, so I go down along the water behind the old hospital, see all kinds of cool stuff going in there. Those are going to be very nice buildings in there. They're planting a bunch of trees. Who knew you could plant trees in October? They're planting that whole parking lot, putting gardens in. It's going to be lovely, I'm sure. We walk the dog, we meet all kinds of things, and it does give you that space to unwind. And like Catherine, all these books that we're going to write, all this content that we're collecting, all this stuff we have to get out of that house, it gives you sort of a framework to collect those things and then to go back home in that discipline of jotting it down or figure out what you're going to do with this stuff. On that show, she talked about this six-year-old boy, Dylan and Jonah, I think the names were, and I've forgotten the name, some bizarre disease, but the one boy had it, and the other boy was his best friend and wanted to do something about it. It was one of those rare one-in-a-million diseases. He needed to get shot. He needed to drink or be injected with a sugar drink because he had no white blood cells, and he couldn't maintain the sugar level, so if he didn't get these shots of sugar, he would die. So Jonah, the friend, tells his mother, well, we have to do something about this. We have to raise money. And he writes a book. And I love this kid because when I'm in crisis, what do? I think I better write a book about something that's going to solve all my problems. And so he did. And he wrote this book about chocolate, which is code to awesomeness. So all the thing that they found was awesome. And the mother took it to her work, and she photocopied it. And all their friends and family bought this book. And it just went on and on and on. The kid ended up making over $1 million for this research. The doctor was blown away because he thought it was a very nice little project for the six-year-old boy to do. And then when they got to the $25,000 mark, that was one thing, but they made it to the $1 million mark. And it just does go to show you that being that creative thing, if you're going to do stained glass buttons, or if you're going to do whatever it is, whatever your heart compels you to do, you can do it. Don't quit your day job right away necessarily, but keep working at it and find some time in your day to do every little bit. The other thing that I would argue is that when everyone comes together, and that's the essence of the Clay It Forward bit, there are about four or five different hands that touch the piece. And you don't need to be an artist to do it. You can be a cookie cutter, you can press your fingertip in, you can leave your mark. And then at the next stage, they'll all be collected to do something else. At the end of this portion of the talk, my table is over there and I have little crowns made because for all the superheroes here. And just ask you to put some color on them. And then we're going to collect them and put them into a mosaic to donate to some fundraising effort for Phoenix Rising. So all of you people will be involved in that thing, leaving your mark. When we have that community coming together for a common cause, it really helps to break down barriers on a lot of levels. When you're working sort of elbow to armpit on a common thing, art or creativity is a great leveler. If you look at community gardens, community kitchens, where people just come together to deal with just the essence of being human on this planet in this moment in space and time, something magic happens. To end the story, because of another awesome experience on St. Joe's Island, I did, at age 53, find my sport. And it's the most bizarre thing because I'm not athletic at all. I'm pretty poorly visually endowed, blind as a bat, in other words. And somehow I got signed up for the archery the archery thing. I would not have done it willingly. The alternative was medicinal marijuana, and I was good with that too. So we end up doing archery, Rob, and I thought, oh my God, okay, these are grown-up people. They're not going to laugh too. They're not going to be too mean to me. They mostly like me. But it turns out that you don't really have to see. You have to stand really still, which I'm good at. Once you get the thing, this contraption, just hold on to your ear and your cheek, stand really, really still. Look through that thing there. It's like right there, so you can see that, and just let her go. And so it's like, bang, dead on. So I found my sport. My friend Susan Hunter was kind enough at the last Toastmasters meeting to give me my little plaque that says best all-around girl, because now I'm an athlete as well. So I will ask you, on my table too, I did bring my little grade 8 creativity award, so I would ask you to take the pose of the superhero creative spirit, stand up, and just go like this. Stand up, superheroes. There you go. Go forth.